Also, a noted scholar and author says, conflict is a normal part of marriage. Mm-hmm. It is not necessarily the conflict that causes divorces. It is how we deal with the conflict. Yeah. And so my question to you all is, how do we deal with conflict? What is the healthy way to forgive? Well, let's just go there. What is forgiveness? How can one forgive in a relationship? Let's start with you, Dr. Brown.
Well, forgiveness, I think it depends on your growing up, your rearing, and mm-hmm. how you've handled that kind of thing. But as an adult and wanting to stay in the marriage, you say, well, I am not perfect. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I err,
right.
And I can tell you some things I do or done, and I know my mate is not terribly pleased with that. And so, you know, go say, well, I'll give him one, I take one.
Right.
And so we can handle it in that way. But we have to know that, when, as you say, we're not Jesus Christ,
mm-hmm.
and we want to be as close to,
amen.
And we want to take these matters to God, mm-hmm. in prayer. If we took more of our matters to God in prayer,
yes.
and tried to handle them less ourselves,
mm-hmm.
Let maybe inexperienced friends and so on handle them,
right.
then we would be better off.
Mm-hmm.
And to keep the things private oft times is better than sharing it and uh-huh. letting each one all around the place explain what they would do and how they would do it, because they are not in the relationship themselves.
Mm.
But what we also have to realize, and I'm realizing it more and more every day, God is not totally pleased with me.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I err,
yes.
but he forgives me.
Yes.
Right.
Even
that's
when
right.
I don't ask, he still lets the sun shine.
Yes.
He uh-huh. still lets there be food on my table.
Yes.
Right.
Now he
right.
wants me to come and say, Lord, forgive me. I offended you by
yes.
doing thus and say, you told me not to do it. And I did it anyway,
mm-hmm.
or you told me to do this and I didn't do it. So he wants that. He inhabits this from us. But he still loves me,
yes.
no matter what. That's unconditional love.
That's unconditional
and
love.
So that's our example.
Yes. And if we can love like the Lord, again, I think we would walk in forgiveness.
Yes.
So, Dr. Tate, what's your take on this thing called forgiveness, and how do we exact that in a relationship?
Yeah, the greatest example for me, and I've preached on this, is from Matthew 18,
mm-hmm.
the story about the master who had a servant that owed him a lot.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And he
yes.
was getting ready to put this guy, I think, in jail and take his wife and children from him. And,
right.
you know,
mm-hmm.
and the guy asked for mercy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, and and the master gave it to him.
Yes.
And then he had a servant. And, of course, his servant owed him very little.
Right.
Nothing compared to what he owed his master, and then of
right.
course he threw him in jail and behaved, you know, really irrational, and how God was just so the master was just so disappointed and mm-hmm. ended up casting him away. What it says to me is that it's like what Dr. Brown was saying, is that when we step back and we look at how we disappoint God and how we let him down, it doesn't compare to how people let us down. It's really, really small.
I agree.
You know what
I
I'm
agree.
Saying?
I agree.
And so when you look at it from that perspective, I think it helps you. It softens your heart. I know it does mine.
Right.
When somebody slights me or does something, and I may get upset, and then I step back and think about how, you know, mm-hmm. many times God has forgiven me.
Mm-hmm.
It softens my heart and says, well, you know what? I can let that go. I can
mm-hmm.
you know, forgive, because God forgives me and I need it, you
right.
know, as a human being. So I think that when we do that, you
mm-hmm.
know, when we see our need for forgiveness, we're able to forgive others
yeah.
and see that they need it too. They need it, you
that's
know.
Right.
You know, they're not perfect. I'm not perfect. So I think that softens our hearts. That helps us to be open
mm-hmm.
to forgive when we do that type of reflection.
Very good. The scriptures in Colossians 3:3 says, bear with each other
mm-hmm.
and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another.
Mm-hmm.
Forgive as the Lord forgave you.
Mm-hmm.
So to forgive doesn't necessarily mean, from my studies, that I don't remember. But it means that I'm dropping the charges.
Yeah.
I remember the old Neil singers back in the day, and they say, Jesus dropped the charges. You remember that song? Maybe not. It's old school. But he dropped the charges. He said, case dismissed.
Yes.
He paid it on Calvary's cross. And so he forgave us of our sins when we confess with our mouths, we believe in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the dead. The Bible says we shall be saved.
Be saved.
It was because of his grace towards us, and it was activated by our faith in him. But when we as humans get into these situations where they're egregious, we are hurt, we're in pain. How do I forgive the person who committed this offense to me? That becomes the rub. And if I don't have unconditional love, which I believe is the foundation of all marriages and relationships, then I am less likely to be able to drop the charges and say, case dismissed. Now, there's some responsibility sometimes. If a person is on, I always use this example, if you're on a death row and you say, Lord, forgive me for all of the murders and crimes I've done, and you go to that family and you say, forgive me for the pain I may have caused your family, it does not necessarily take away the penalty that you have to pay.
Right, there's consequences.
Consequences that you have to pay. But you're forgiven. The Lord says, come on up to heaven. But so I think sometimes there are consequences. And I always tell people, forgiveness does not necessarily, and this might be a little tougher for you guys to get your hands around, but I'm going to challenge you on this one. Forgiveness does not necessarily mean reconciliation. So what say ye? In other words, if I forgave someone in a relationship, that doesn't mean that I'm cozying up to them necessarily day one.
Well, I've often used this analogy. I give you the keys of my car. You take my car and you run it into the side of the road. And you come back and say, you know, I'm sorry I did that. You know, and I say, okay, you know, no problem. And then next week you ask, can I use your car again? I said, well, no, I don't think so.
Okay.
Because I've forgiven you, but I don't trust you. See,
I like where you're going.
You have to earn trust.
Yeah.
See, I can forgive you, but it doesn't mean I'm going to let you use my car again.
So you just said something. So you're saying forgiveness erodes away the trust in a relationship. Wow, that's powerful. Now that's powerful, because to get reconciliation, I agree with you that you must have forgiveness plus trust. In other words, if someone had an affair, committed some kind of egregious offense against that loved one or that mate, the way to get back together is you got to earn trust again. And it takes time to earn trust. Remember, trust is not something you see. It's not something I can just pick up like I pick up this water bottle. Trust is intangible. It's an emotion. It's a feeling. I feel like I can trust you based on what I see, the results, reality, reliability. And that's what you're talking about in your car example, which is a perfect example. Dr. Brown, you have any comments on that? I think that's a great example on reconciliation.
Yeah, I think you've really covered it. But what I want to say, we were talking about relationships. Now, if it's marriage, and we didn't really specify. Well, did you specify marriage?
I did not.
You just said relationships
in
general.
But in this case, we were focusing on a relationship and marriage.
Marriage. But you see, some people marry for various reasons.
Yes. That's right.
Then some people marry for
the
long haul, for life. And others are just to when I get what I can get.
Okay.
Or achieve what I, you know?
Right.
And so
you're talking about commitment in this case.
Yeah, if there's no commitment on one hand and longevity on the other hand, what can you do if the one that had a short-term commitment?
That's right.
You see, so there it just leaves you.
That's right. And I believe that is a part of relationships. There will some will come in with the mindset that I'm not here to stay married to you. I want to enjoy myself a little while, or I may have what I call the Hollywood mindset, which I can just marry, divorce, divorce. In fact, if 40 to 50% of all first marriages end in divorce, 65%, it is reported, of all second marriages end in divorce. So people think if I get married again, I got it right this time. Actually, the reverse happens. Conversely, they end up divorcing even more so. And if you marry a third time, it gets worse. And it gets into the 70th percentile. Because the people did not change, and they went in with the same baggage, the same mindset. And see, we're going to get to this end before this show is over, is how do I then, what are some techniques I can do to build healthy relationship? But right now I want to set the foundation on some of these key things towards that end, which is, again, we must learn to forgive. I said this in the book. If you don't learn to forgive, your marriage is doomed to end.
Well, it's just like stealing, lying, and other vices. Some people, the more they get away with it, the more they're going to do it. They don't understand the compassion that, that the person is giving them at the time. They just keep because they lie. Well, this story about a snake. It said the man had a pet snake, and one day the snake bit him. And the man said, "Why did you do that? I feed you, I take care, I house you." And the snake said, "You knew I was a snake."
That's a good example.
And so you
marry someone who's a snake.
And so there you are.
Destined to bite you.
And so you, you know, you
could. But you're kind of violent today. George and snakes. I don't know if we're helping the people.
Well, that's not all I say to the people is don't marry a snake.
Don't marry a snake.
Look into the genealogy of the person.
So and that's something. Get to that. We're going to get to I want you to hold that because I'm going to start with you then on this next question, which is dealing with how do you know if you're single? How do you know to find that right person? So we're talking about the foundation of unconditional love, right? We're talking about how a relationship with God helps build unconditional love. But when you don't have that strong relationship with God and experiencing His unconditional love, it makes it difficult in our humanness to love unconditionally, which means that it's not an eye for an eye, but it's I'm going to love you, I'm going to do unto you as I would have you do unto me, even though you did something else to me. And so then we move to forgiveness, and because that's so important in enduring relationships, and we talked about, and I like what Dr. Tate brought out, is reconciliation does not come without trust being restored.
That's right.
So that same car analogy you use, eventually that person over time might demonstrate in other areas that they have fulfill what you have asked them to do. Now you say, okay, can I get the key again? You're like, all right, you've demonstrated over time that you are accountable and trustworthy. Now I give you the key again. Now, that's don't violate it again. To the same thing. So reconciliation is very important. But what would you say to those going with Dr. Brown's point, which is right in track of what we want to cover, is what would you say to those who are single today and they may be tuning in and they're saying, I'm looking for the right mate. What are some key attributes that one should look for?
Yeah, the word genealogy came up. And we do need to know. You need to know the background of the person. So it doesn't hurt now. We've got all kind of media and all kind of back.
Do a little research.
Do some research. And do get into that deeply, very deeply. Background checks and the whole nine yards are very important. We think, oh, I just love him, and I'm going to, it'll be all right. Love's going to do it all.
Well, that's the honeymoon stage, right? Whenever you meet someone like, oh, she's so good. She smells good. She looks good. He looks great. He does no wrong. But then disillusionment sets in. Reality.
So we need to know much more than how the person looks, how they talk, how they walk.
That's right.
How they act in our presence. So, you know, what are some of the other relationships they've had?
That's right.
And is it, are you free to talk to the person?
But you these know? Days, Dr. Brown, you go from meeting a person to having sex with a person. Hello.
Well,
I mean, day you meet at a club and you go and have sex. Some people meet at churches and conferences and go and have sex. They don't know this person.
Well, they're out of order, strictly out of order. Mm-hmm. And you can't make two rights, two wrongs don't make a right.
Yes.
So, you know, you started out wrong. You started out on the left foot. Mm-hmm. Now, how are you going to get this thing back on the right foot? Mm-hmm. What does the scripture say about this? What does it say about adultery, fornication? And so, and you can look at me and say, well, you fornicated with me. And you say, well, you fornicated. So we both were wrong.
Right, that doesn't make it right, yeah. So Dr. Tate, what would you say to those who are single and they're trying to figure out what are the attributes? Dr. Brown talked about the genealogy, find out who they are, how they act around mothers, fathers, friends, in different environments
That's
and jobs.
Right.
What are some other tips that you would like to share?
Yeah, I think everything Dr. Brown said is point on. One of the things, the first things I would do is tell them to seek the Lord, you know, to pray and get insight from God on who you are, your personality, how your upbringing has affected you, how experiences in your life have affected you. You talked about baggage earlier.
Yes.
You know, you need to understand yourself. You need to understand your strength and your weaknesses. Get a handle on that. And to get insight from God who you are compatible with, the type of person that you are compatible with. Because you're not going to be compatible with everybody.
Right.
You know, and then going to what Dr. Brown was saying, I think it's important to understand a person's background and history and to be able to see a person when they're happy, sad, upset, see them in different situations. We're so quick to just jump, you know, like you say, and have sex and whatever, or get married.
Commit even without knowing
right,
the person.
Knowing the person. You're really
you
knowing
know
who they are.
They are. And you're like, wedding bells are ringing.
Right.
Because
right.
I want to be connected. I want to be in a relationship.
Right, exactly. And those are important. And to understand that having premarital sex really fogs the mind. It doesn't give you a clear mind on who this person is. Now the emphasis is more on the physical.
Yes.
You know, and you begin not to see the crucial things that you need to see when you start having sex.
Right.
And then when you get married and you wonder, well, where did this come from? But it was already there, but you were too busy having sex.
You couldn't see it.
So it's those type of things that we, you know, I would say to a person.
Well, those are good. There's an author, and I can't recall his name, but he wrote the book, How Not to Marry a Jerk.